everyone, and welcome to the Power 365 show. We're excited to be back with another episode today, this time with John Gravely. You know, he's had a lot of success in the partner ecosystem, particularly as an ISV with C360 Solutions, and then a success, of course, with Click Dimensions in more recent times. Well, he's back. He's got a new company to talk to us about today. I'm the lucky guy that's actually involved with this company, but before I let the cat out of the bag, why don't we go to air and have a chat? Full show notes for this episode, of course, will be found at nz365guy.com/158. Hey, John, welcome back to the show.
Hey, Mark, how are you?
Good, man, good. It's been a while since we did a podcast together. I think it was about, I don't know, coming up 2 years ago when I first interviewed you on what you're doing with your life at the time. So it's good to get you back on.
It's good to be here. I really appreciate it, Mark. Thanks so much.
Cheers, man. So where do you live nowadays? What part of the world are you in?
Yeah, I'm in a little town called Dunwoody, Georgia, which is really, for all intents and purposes, part of Atlanta, Georgia.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and what's your idea of non-work time? What do you do for play?
Well, I remember when you interviewed me before, I was talking a lot of game about spearfishing.
That's it, up in Iceland as well, right? Diving?
Yeah, I did some diving there, but yeah, still very much into that. My son, who just turned 16, goes with me, and we shoot together, and we do spear fishing and fishing and diving, and just really anything to be outside is what kind of recharges my batteries.
Do you particularly enjoy ocean-based activities?
I do. I love to dive. I love to find new stuff. You know, it's almost like a big scavenger hunt when you're out there with your boat and your GPS, and you're trying to find a new reef or a new wreck or something like that to dive. It's a lot of fun.
Nice, nice. Where's your best dive site so far?
Oh my gosh. Well, we have a place down in Florida where we dive out of a lot. We've got our own boat and gear and stuff like that. So I think I tend to like that. But, you know, I mentioned to you, we did a cool dive in Iceland, and I've been a lot of places. It's been a lot of fun.
Nice, nice. So what about family? You mentioned your son. How many children do you have? Wife?
Yeah, I've got a wife, if you can believe it.
I can.
No, I've been married for almost 20 years. It'll be 20 years in December. I work with my wife. She's worked with me and my two startups, C360 and Click Dimensions. I've got a 16-year-old son who's a stud. I've got a 13-year-old daughter who's amazing. I have a great family and a cat. Got a cat too.
Wow. Do you know what? I've got a question at the end, and you just kind of answered what that question's going to be. So we'll see what happens with that. But tell me, what's your origin story? If you bump into somebody for the first time, let's say at a meet and greet business event, something like that, and they say, you know, so John, what have you been up to with your life? What's your story of how you've got to where you are today?
Yeah, you know, I think there are a couple of things. One is I came from a very rural and modest state in the United States called West Virginia. And so they're, you know, very impoverished state. I think that was something that had an impact on me. But I also was able at the same time to go to a private boarding school. So I moved away from my family in high school, and I went to a pretty affluent private boarding school. And I think that shaped me in terms of, you know, the types of people that I was around and, you know, what I wanted to do with my life. My father was an entrepreneur. So, you know, he had like car washes and gas stations and things, and was always out wheeling and dealing. So that influence. But, you know, actually when I went to college, I went to a university called Clemson, which you may know of because we're national champs in college collegiate football. But I majored in construction science, and that got me in front of computers, and I got kind of hooked as to what the potential of the computer could be. I used to have a Mac, you know, the one that looked like a human head, which was a Mac SE. Yeah. And I would actually take it to class and plug it in, you know, back in the days before anybody took a computer anywhere. So I was kind of a geek that way. So there's all these influences sort of all my life led me to the point where I just felt like, you know, I have to own my own businesses. And so I've had two businesses in the Dynamics world. I've had C360 Solutions, where we built just basically what ended up being missing functionality into Dynamics. And then another one called Click Dimensions, which builds marketing automation functionality for Dynamics.
So with two, you know, startups under your belt, both cases exited successfully, you know, you're obviously an entrepreneur. Do you like wearing that hat? Are you comfortable with it?
Well, you know, I would say in a sense, no. For being somebody that can say that I've started and sold two businesses, I would think I would be more of a risk taker And, you know, I don't feel like I am, but I think it's because it's more calculated risk that I want to take. You know, I'll go diving and I'll be shooting fish that are bleeding and I'll have sharks around me. And that doesn't bother me because I've calculated the risk about, you know, what can go wrong there and how you deal with it. But in business, you know, I think I'm kind of doing the same thing. You know, I'm looking at it and thinking, okay, do I have access to this market? Are there enough partners or whatever to make this work? And so I think it's all very calculated.
Yeah. But like, there's a lot of people that have started, whether they be ISV businesses or even SI practices, and it's not ended up, you know, with a necessary a positive outcome around the world. Like in your case, you've been very focused, it seems, from an outsider looking in, that, you know, you saw the opportunity with C360 and that the original CRM application had a bunch of functionality that people wanted and was missing. And you filled that niche in the market, you addressed it, and then you saw another niche, in this case, you know, with the lack of functionality around marketing in the CRM application at the time. And so you capitalized on that. Like, is that a trait that you are always looking for? You know, what's missing? What is the market looking for? And could you put something together that meets that need?
You know, that sounds really like that would make me out to be a really smart guy. And I think it's really more the case that I'm just kind of patently unemployable. And so I have to come up with a way to give myself jobs because I don't do well working for people. So,
yeah,
I'm always sort of looking for, you know, what makes sense and what can you do with a, you know, like I said, with a calculated level of risk.
Yeah. I don't think anyone would deny you've had the most successful ISV exit in the industry based on our last discussions, the last podcast. I think, did you say it was 60 million odd was the exit there? A lot of people would love to have that type of success. What in your mind does it take to be a successful Microsoft ISV?
Yeah, you know, I really think the main thing is you just have to really understand the importance and the value of the partner. You work through partners. You don't try to work around them. Those organizations really provide so much value. There's so many great people running them too, that you have to understand that, and you have to work with them, be fair with them. You also have to understand how to work with Microsoft and understand what their goals are and how you fit into those goals. And those are honestly, you know, the main things. And then obviously, you know, the basic things. You have to build a great product. It has to have a great value proposition. You have to have your unit economics down, you know, good retention, which you'll have if you work through partners who will keep your customers happy. You know, low CAC, customer acquisition costs, which you'll have if you work through partners. So it's really understanding the unit economics of the product you're selling and having a great product that you sell at a fair price.
Hey, John, you mentioned an interesting term there, which is around unit economics. Can you unpack that for us?
Yeah, so in SaaS software businesses, unit economics generally refers to a combination of, you know, what you're selling your product for per year, so the average revenue per user, or ARPU, some people would call it, your retention, your customer acquisition costs, what does it take you to onboard, you know, a customer in terms of costs, and then what is the lifetime value of the customer? So, you know, if your retention is really good, you'll keep a customer for, I don't know, 5 years, 10 years, and you're charging, you know, $10,000 a year, so it's $50,000 or $100,000 of lifetime value of that customer. Those are the components that really tell you whether you have a scalable and successful software business.
So what about when you think about profitability of an organization? You know, I see a lot in the media about companies that, you know, they try to scale quickly. They go and try and get as much investment funds into the business, and they spend it on a lot of activities that don't necessarily lead in the short or even medium term to a profit. What do you think about when it comes to profitability of a company in its early days?
Yeah, you know, there's different models. There are people that are, you know, trying to do something really, really that requires funding, and they have to do that, and that's the model they want. And then there are people that, you know, because of the efficiency of how they can get to market, can start a business and self-fund it. That's what I've done. Doesn't mean I'm any smarter than anybody else. It's just the type of business. You know, I also have been building, you know, software products for a pretty defined market. You know, if I were going to go out and try to, I don't know, engineer an artificial heart or something like that, I would probably need funding.
Yeah, exactly. So what are kind of key lessons you have learned? Perhaps our listeners could benefit from those in the experience of these last two startups, and kind of, is there anything you'd do differently?
Yeah, there's a lot I'd do differently, just like anything. You'd look back on your life and say, oh man, I wish I could do this differently or that differently, you know, but life is mainly about, you know, what you did do, not regretting, you know, the things, you know, that you would have done differently. It's mainly, you know, did I get out there and do things, which is great. Mm-mm. You know, the main lesson that I've learned in both the companies and in as I think about future things is about the people that you have around you. It just really pays to have quality people that are not only good at their jobs, but, you know, good at being good people, you know, good at doing the right things, good at treating a partner the right way, or treating a customer the right way, or treating, you know, their teammates the right way. It's all about having the right people in the right seat on the bus with the right, you know, freedom to do what they need to be able to do for the organization.
Yeah. Yeah. And so what would you do differently?
What would I do differently? There's a lot that I would do the same because the outcome has been good. So if I look back and I think, man, I would have changed this and that, you know, maybe it would have worked, maybe it wouldn't have. So it's really hard to answer that because, you know, I can certainly point to a lot of mistakes. But when you end up in a place that's good, you kind of realize that, you know, maybe I wouldn't go back and tinker too much with things.
Yeah, exactly. Time travel is not necessarily a smart idea. What, you know, in the situation with, you know, I remember being in New Zealand, which, you know, after 7 years back here again, is I remember back in the day starting my own Microsoft consultancy, boutique consultancy business, and you know, C360 was a product that we sold in our deals. And then, you know, I remember meeting you in Queensland, Australia, when you just, the year you launched Click Dimensions. And in each time they filled gaps as, you know, my SI that I needed. But what I found interesting, and I've only kind of found it more interesting in hindsight, is it's not easy for an ISV to create a global business. And I tell you why I think that. One, you have to deal with a 24/7 support model to some degree, right? Because, you know, it's always on somewhere in the world. People are always doing business at some point in some time zone. Second, you need to be able to transact in global markets, and they come with nuances even with the Azure data centers around where deployments are done. And then the third one is the support model that you have around that. In fact, I might have repeated that. So support model, international transactions, and how do you scale an international sales force? So what do you consider when building a global business that are going to operate in, you know, multiple geographies from the get-go? What crosses your mind about things to get right?
Yeah, well, the main thing you get right is you really work well with the partner channel, because if you have partners in Australia, in New Zealand, in the United Kingdom, in, you know, the United States, then you obviously have that sort of regional know-how and presence built in. And so you can take care of a lot of things. Even you mentioned billing, you know, you can just simplify a lot of that through having partners. But really, the partner is your front line of defense, not only in the sales cycle, but in making sure that the customer implements the software, actually uses the software, you know, finds value from it, renews in, you know, subsequent years. All these things are really important. So I think the partner channel is what makes the Dynamics ecosystem, I think, unique and different from the Salesforce ecosystem, quite honestly, in being able to reach out and be global and, you know, support customers, you know, 24/7 and things like that.
Yeah, yeah. So how long has it been now since you exit from Click?
I think it's been almost 3 years.
Wow.
In January, 3 years in January. Yeah. You're making me do math, Mark. Don't make me do math.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I would assume in that situation, you're a young man, that you must be getting itchy feet to do something new. What have you been up to for the last 12 months?
Well, I think you're letting our cat out of its bag, Mark. So what you and I and a couple other very clever people have been doing is we're building a new startup that's called SalesSpark. And SalesSpark is a sales engagement solution built on the Power Platform. And it is just an amazing product. Scott Duro and his team have built just an amazing piece of software, and what I'm told and I believe is the most sophisticated power app that's on the platform at this point.
Yeah, I think you made a massively right decision in involving Scott in this project. You know, he's come from a massive history in the community of building, you know, tools that, you know, have had over 1 million downloads. They're used by so many partners, so many customers with the Ribbon Workbench and Sparkle and things like that. And the thing is, you know, what I like about Scott, he likes to do the job right. You know, it's not a case of getting it done quickly, taking shortcuts or anything like that. He really puts his reputation on the line. But enough about me saying how wonderful Scott is. Tell me, what have you done then in the last 12 months? Like what have you been doing? What have you been putting in place? SalesSpark is obviously this amazing product around sales engagement, but what led you to that point?
Yeah, so, you know, I've been doing some consulting with companies, and it's been more around, you know, getting their sales and lead generation to a point that really allows them to grow. And in doing this, I started to recognize that these solutions that are referred to as sales engagement solutions really move the needle for companies. So what they do is, you know, you think of modern sales functionality in a CRM, and it's kind of like a system of record. Like you can, you know, go have a call with a prospect and you can log it, and you can have an opportunity and you can log it. And so you're recording a lot of things, and it's a lot of work for the salesperson. But sales engagement functionality actually automates ongoing, consistent contact with prospects. And it's through a mechanism called sequencing. So, you know, imagine you have 500 target accounts, and maybe you have 2 or 3 personas per target account. You need something that's going to reach out to these targets, these prospects, in your own voice, in a manner that's going to get to them, in a manner that's authentic and personalized. And that's what sequences in sales engagement solutions are. And that's what we've built in SalesSpark.
Wow. So that's very interesting. Like, I wrote a post a couple of months ago around, I felt that CRM systems were really built on 20-year-old technology. They hadn't evolved so much. Yeah, there's been some more analytics and insights around, you know, what's happened or reporting on the results. But you're talking about, you know, a totally new way of engaging with customers that, so I suppose it's not so much targeted as sales managers, but actually at the actual sales individuals, people that are selling in the market.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, it turns CRM from being a system of record to a system of action. You know, imagine you hear all the time about how it takes somewhere between 10 and 20 touch points to get a response from a prospect. Well, you know, a lot of that's been manual work, with the additional burden of logging into CRM after you do the manual work. What SalesSpark as a sales engagement solution does is it'll let you build these sequences. So for example, a sequence might be, you know, day one, an email sent. Day two, you know, you're prompted to have a call with a prospect. You know, day five, you have a reply that automatically goes out to your day one email that says, hey, did you get my email? You know, would love to set up a meeting, and so on and so forth, doing things like emails and phone calls and LinkedIn interactions and tasks, automating all this for you so that you're working with your prospects in a very consistent manner, reaching out to them and never letting a ball drop and never showing up and wondering, what do I need to do next? Who do I need to call next? Who do I need to, you know, send an email to? That's what sales engagement automates for salespeople. And by the way, it is good for the sales leadership too, because they can very clearly see where everybody is with their prospects, you know, how many activities, you know, one rep is doing versus another, and what the overall outcome and, you know, effectiveness of these sales programs is.
Mm-hmm. I mean, often in sales, one of the challenges that people have, and particularly not closing or not moving a sales forward, is actually lack of communication. And really, sequencing is going to really allow you to monitor and proactively engage with customers in your own voice.
Yeah, it is. And what's so fun about SalesSpark, the company and the app that we've built, you know, yourself included, Mark, is just that knowing that, you know, as we are launching this, the very first tool we really need to do it is SalesSpark. We need these sales engagement sequences to reach out to partners, to reach out to Microsoft people, to let them know what we're doing, but then also to nudge them and to follow up with them if they've been busy and haven't been able to get back in touch with us. So automating our sales process with hundreds of partners and, you know, dozens, if not hundreds, of Microsoft, you know, influencers is what SalesSpark does for us internally and what it's going to do for our partners and our customers.
Yeah, so interesting. I've just come off a call with Hayden Stafford. Now, he's the corporate vice president at Microsoft of Microsoft Business Applications worldwide. He owns the number for that. And he revealed an interesting piece of information. They are over doubling their sales headcount in FY20. That's this year.
It's good for us, Mark.
Almost 3,000 sellers, that's what they're getting close to around the world, that are, you know, working with, you know, partners and through partners and bringing the Power Platform, Dynamics 365 sales to market. And they're seeing an absolute boom in growth around the what he calls the finished applications, the Dynamics 365 apps that are there. And of course, I take it the way, you know, we've been developing SalesSpark, not only is it natively born on the Power Platform and will work on the Power Platform independently of anything else, we've also designed it to work with Dynamics 365 sales.
Absolutely, yeah. So, you know, that's the cool thing about building apps these days versus, you know, building them 10 years ago is, you know, just by building on the Power Platform, your app is native to the first-party apps like Dynamics Sales, Dynamics Marketing, and whatnot. But to run SalesSpark, you only need the Power App, you know, single app license. So you can have, you know, salespeople that have, that are, maybe they're just a BDR team and they're just using SalesSpark and the basic license, or maybe they're account executives and they're using SalesSpark with Dynamics 365 sales. It all just works together and it's very, very seamless. And it's just looking at the product again, I can't say enough good things about what Scott and his team have built. It's just easy. It just goes right in. It's slick. It works. It's fantastic.
So tell me about BDR, as in, you know, some people might not understand what it is. What is a BDR team?
Yeah, so SalesSpark works for account executives, you know, or otherwise known as closing reps, for BDRs or SDRs, which are business development reps or sales development reps, which are basically inside salespeople, for customer success managers, and for account managers. So all of your traditional sales roles in an organization can benefit from having the automation that comes from sales engagement and sequencing that SalesSpark provides. You know, BDRs obviously are one part of that. They're generally folks that are trying to get the initial appointment set with, you know, with a prospect, and then that gets handed up to a closing rep like an account executive.
So, you know, my experience, 20-odd years, I have had various sales roles and functions over that time, and one pattern I often noticed, no matter what company I was working for, industry in, is kind of the mountains and valleys of sales, right? So you're out, you're selling, you're engaging, but while you're doing that, you're not necessarily engaging with your business of tomorrow, right? And so, you know, you're on this big peak, climbing this peak, you make this big sale, and then, you know, as I say, you're only as good as your last sale, and all of a sudden you're like, wow, I now need to find my next, you know, my next opportunity to work on. How do I do that? SalesSpark is really addressing the predictability, isn't it, around consistent sales pipeline and communication engagement with target customers?
Yeah, absolutely. So when we sum up the benefits of SalesSpark, we think about, you know, making your sales team, all your sales roles, more productive. So giving them 2 or 3 hours of their day back, increasing the number of appointments you book that can lead to sales qualified leads, you know, anywhere from 10 to 25%. Therefore, increasing the number of opportunities by a similar fashion, and then ultimately increasing the revenue of the company. I love selling products and building products that actually move the needle. And SalesSpark, you know, having put different sales engagement solutions in different consulting clients of mine, I've just seen it. When this sequencing functionality goes into play, you know, the leads go up. And I think one thing that we haven't talked about a lot or at all, I think, is just the tie-in with Office 365. So not only does SalesSpark work with Dynamics 365 sales and on the Power Platform, but it's designed to really be, it's like a virtual assistant for the salesperson. So it's connecting to each salesperson's Office 365. And the email part, the emails it's sending actually are coming from the individual salesperson's Office 365 account. So, you know, you put a SalesSpark sequence into play with a contact, and you start seeing in your outbox, or excuse me, in your send items, you start seeing the emails that it's sending on your behalf. It's like, you know, you're asleep and this thing's working for you. It's amazing.
Yeah. So that's the interesting thing, where a lot of kind of mailing application, particularly like the mail applications that you've seen kind of in the marketing space, it gets sent from mail servers, right, that do this in bulk, and then they might abstract away the to from that type of thing and replace it with something else. This is actually using each salesperson's own email address, as in not only that, it's actually going from their inbox. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. But you know, you allude to marketing applications. This is not a competitive thing to marketing applications, including, you know, Dynamics Marketing or Click Dimensions. It's really something that works compatibly with these, because, you know, you can be doing your marketing and you can be working your leads above the funnel, and SalesSpark is really helping you, you know, turn these into actual appointments and deals there at the bottom of the funnel.
Mm-mm-mm. So what do you see the need for this new sales technology? Because, you know, for years, people had CRMs, they've had their Outlooks and email system, and they could, you know, manually go up to places like LinkedIn and do some research. But really, it hasn't changed, as I said, in the last 20 years. So based on what we've built so far, what do you see as future states of where we're thinking about going?
Well, this, you know, again, this is something that takes it from being a burden and a system of record where you're logging things to being a help and being a system of action that's actually doing things for you. You know, day in the life of a salesperson, you might go in and you might spend a few hours researching your prospects, putting them in a sequence, and then following up on activities that your sequences from, you know, the past few days have left for you. So it's doing a lot of automation for you. You know, things that you'd be doing if you had two or three people working for you, it's automating. It's doing those things automatically.
Yeah. John, so you mentioned that, you know, SalesSpark works natively with Office 365, particularly around the email function of that platform. What about Microsoft Teams? You know, we're seeing this massive growth of Microsoft Teams. People are now, you know, digital natives are pretty much sitting inside Teams in their day-to-day function. Salespeople the same, whether it's communicating with other colleagues in the office and or accessing any other tools provided by the Power Platform. Are you making sure that Microsoft Teams is front and center as part of this offering?
Yeah, for sure. So because we built SalesSpark on the Power Platform, it's a Power app, that means it can surface through the Teams user interface, no problem. It's already there.
Excellent, excellent. So tell me then, why did you choose a Microsoft Power Platform? You know, you've come from a background with Dynamics. You've seen changes. Naturally, in your position, you would have looked at other platforms available in market. What compelled you to go with the Microsoft Power Platform?
Well, mainly because we're so, you know, the people I've worked with and just the experience I have is so, you know, so tied up with Microsoft and with just the amazing partner channel that Microsoft has. It made sense to build on Microsoft technology. It was just more of lucky coincidence that the time we're building this whole new paradigm shift to the Power Platform is happening because, you know, as I said before, you know, our solution requires the base level license, yet it works natively and, you know, hand in glove with Dynamics 365 sales. Plus, we get so much functionality just by building on that platform. We get the common data service, you know, we get all the, you know, standard entities that we can access. We've got all this plumbing and, you know, feature and functionality that just comes along with it. It was kind of, at this point, a no-brainer.
So a day or so ago now, we've officially launched SalesSpark. Who's on the team? Who's on the bus for the launch?
Yeah, so the leadership team is really exciting for SalesSpark. Obviously, you know, you're on the team in a capacity of sales and evangelism, and you've been part of it since we really only started this in June of this year, June 2019. And so you were one of the very first people there. Kim, who we talked about earlier, my wife, is the chief operating officer and chief financial officer, which that's what she did for both C360 and Click Dimensions. And then Scott Duro, who's the CTO and has built the app, is just phenomenal, you know, going from a kind of rickety wireframe that I built to building just a beautiful application that works so well and takes advantage of power control framework and power apps in such an elegant way. I mean, I just can't say enough good things about the work he's done. And then joining us in January is Allison Macedo, who came from Click Dimensions and is going to work with us in the capacity of product management and customer success. And she's just a phenomenal talent. So that's our core team at this point.
Yeah, fantastic. So obviously the first 12 months in any startup is where, you know, it's validated, you know, yeah. does the market, you know, have the appetite for it? What are your plans in the next 12 months?
Yeah, our plans are to, you know, continue to build out the product, to obviously go to the partner channel and start to add partners as both customers and partners. And then through the partner channel, you know, build a customer base of companies that, you know, that want to generate more revenue, that want to increase their lead flow.
So if we were looking at a market, you know, that ahead of us in the next 12 months, I suppose anybody that has Dynamics 365 sales already in place would be an obvious candidate for SalesSpark.
Yes, absolutely. That's the target.
So when partners are considering, you know, is there something else that I can, you know, often partners now are building kind of long-term relationships with their customers. They're not just going in and selling a point solution. They go in, they might have implemented, you know, a Dynamics application or the Power Platform, and they'll be looking at adding value to that customer over time. Is that the type of Microsoft partners that we're looking for, that, you know, value and engage with their customer for the long journey and can see how this technology can enable them and also give them opportunity to you know, strengthen their relationship with their customer base?
Absolutely, Mark. It's all about results, you know, and if we can go in with the partner and bring a piece to the technology stack that helps, you know, helps the organization increase their leads by 10 or 20, 25%, you know, I think they're going to have a very happy long-term customer.
So it's safe to say we're launching with a partner program.
Absolutely.
Okay, so tell us, where can people that want to either, one, get involved in the partner program today and or learn about SalesSpark, what are the kind of resources out there they can engage with?
Yeah, so we've got the website at salesspark.com. If you want to sign up to be a partner, just hit the partnership inquiry form under the partner menu on the website. If you want to, we've got a demo video up there. You can watch it anytime. That'll give you a quick, you know, 3 or 4 minute overview of the solution. We've got a form up there for requesting a scheduled demo if you want to go into more detail. And then, you know, there's a phone number. Just call us.
Yeah, fantastic. And I mean, you know, Scott, myself, both MVPs, we're out in the community. We've engaged for many years now. And, you know, we're fully expecting for people to hit us up on LinkedIn Messenger, engage with us, you know, reach out if you want to see some more details or go in or unpack, you know, even, you know, experience with the Power App component framework. You know, that journey that we've been on particularly has been quite an incredible one over the last couple of months. A lot of lessons learned that we haven't talked about yet. But yeah, feel free, engage, reach out. You know, we're very informal. You know, we're very approachable. And we'll always shoot a straight game with you. So we'd love to hear from you, love to engage with you and perhaps, you know, see how SalesSpark can work with you. Now, with all my podcasts, I do like to close with a few things. So first of all, is there anything you want to add in closing, John?
I think we've covered it all. I want to really emphasize the results portion of, you know, what using sales engagement functionality can do for an organization. If you haven't heard about it, you know, take a look at the video on the website, request a demo. I mean, I have seen this several times, just really increase the lead flow for companies. So, you know, just to pay attention to it. It's super hot now, and the players in the space are just all doing extremely well.
Awesome. Okay, so let's jump onto some quick fire questions. This is not necessarily about our business, but more about getting to know you a bit better from an audience perspective. Okay, would you rather watch a movie at home or at the movie theater?
Oh man, at home. Easy.
Okay. What book has made the biggest impact in your life?
You know, that's a tough question. I'll give you a great book to read. It's called Sailing Alone Around the World. It's about a guy named Joshua Slocum, who solo circumnavigated the globe from 1895 to 1898. And just, you know, thinking about somebody with the, you know, with the, just the courage to go into unknown like that is just super inspirational. And so I always find that to be a very, uplifting read. I've read it two or three or four times.
Wow. I can't believe you said 1895. Did you say that?
1895 to 1898. This guy by himself sailed all the way around the globe. He was the first one, you know, in recorded history to do that. Probably, most definitely, probably the first one to ever do it.
Crazy.
Yeah, kind of crazy.
What's the three biggest turning points of your life?
Man, you should have given me these in advance. You didn't give me these in advance.
No, none of these come in advance. This is like with all guests.
I can't answer that one. There's too many rat holes to go down answer that one.
That's so good. How did you meet your best friend?
In kindergarten.
Wow. Yeah. Here it is. This is a link back to up the start. Are you a cat or a dog person?
I think both. I like them both, but I don't have the patience to have a dog.
Gotcha. Okay, that's interesting. So you lean towards cats. There's a lot of cat lovers in the community.
Mm-hmm.
If you could only keep three things from your house, and we're not talking about people, what were those three things that you would pick? You know, the house is on fire. You can grab three things. What are they?
I don't know. You don't need a computer or an iPhone because you've got it all in the cloud.
Mm-hmm.
So it wouldn't be that. I don't know. Maybe my passport. That's probably my passport and my wallet.
I thought you'd be grabbing some of your guitars or something like that.
You can buy more of those.
True. Valid. John, it's been awesome to have you on the show.
Yeah, thanks.
If people want to, are you blogging or anything? Can people follow what you're talking about online?
You know, I haven't been, but I will be blogging through LinkedIn and through the SalesSpark website, and we'll be pushing stuff out through the SalesSpark Twitter.
Hey, thanks for joining us today on the Power 365 show. Well, I hope you found that interesting. I've definitely been dropping hints over the last couple of months that I was working on something new. And this is it. It's now live. Remember, full show notes for this episode can be found at nz365guy.com/158. I would be keen to hear your thoughts and feedback. Check out the website, salesspark.com. Let me know what you think. And if you want to have a chat, make sure you reach out and get in touch. Bye for now.